We have a nice turnout tonight. This is really the first opportunity of this election season to see all the folks who are running for the three seats on Marin County's Board of Supervisors. I'm Dick Spotswood, the politics and government columnist for the Marin Independent Journal, and it's been my pleasure to be asked to be your moderator tonight. Where is Jody?
I'm right here.
Did you say a few words?
Well, that's okay. I just wanted to welcome everybody here and thank you for coming. Well, we're not going to take a lot of time because we have 13 candidates and we want to hear what they have to say. Thank you again for coming.
Jody is El Jefe at the Citizens.
You're hosting.
Stand up. Thank you. It's become a dynamic group that has really changed the conversation, at least if it comes to the issue of public employee pensions here in Marin County. So, better?
Yes. Say that again.
Naturally shy. Let's tell you the ground rules tonight. It'll be really simple. We have hopefully 13 candidates, and we're going to give each of them a chance to start with a 3-minute opening statement. When we finish, we're going to do that alphabetical by district. In other words, we'll start in the second district or the third and the fourth. We'll then have questions, three from the sponsoring group. That's usually done in Marin County. They only have three, which is pretty restrained tonight. They'll be asked to all the candidates. We're going to ask the candidates to keep your comments, your answers, to 30 seconds to a minute, if you can. There is a reward for yes, no, and I don't know. But I understand that you want to go a little bit more, and that's right. But we're going to ask you to do that. And the good news is you don't have to worry about your good self-sense of timings. We have a timer here right in the front row who will make an obnoxious sound, which will be clear.
More cowbell.
And we'll give you a couple of seconds to finish up your sentence, but please, we really want to get as many questions as possible from the folks out there. You have had an opportunity to fill out cards, and I have them. There's more cards than we're ever going to get you. But thank you. And we'll somehow sort through those and try to make them representative of the questions being asked. We're going to give, so I know some questions are directed to a particular candidate or supervisor. That question will go then to them first. It's only fair. But I'm going to give anybody else a chance who wishes to chime in on it. One or two, Mike, a chance to chime in on it and give their response. But I'm going to ask all those folks in those long questions to really be as quick as you can. And the briefer the answer, the more time we have for more questions. So 30 seconds to a minute. We're going to revolve around to start with. And then we're going to take a break around 8 o'clock to 10 minutes, just so people can take a break and breathe for a bit. And then we'll reconvene, finish up the questions. And at the end, every candidate will be given 3 minutes to tell you why you should vote for them. And we're going to start in opposite order. So we start our far right over here. We're going to go down, and we'll start on the opposite end. So everybody gets a chance to be different places in the agenda. So that's the deal. Do the candidates, like a prize fight, do the candidates have any questions?
Where are we starting?
And you wrote these?
No.
That's okay. That'd be kind of innovative. I like that. Yeah, that's good. Thank you. So that's the deal. So let's get underway, and we're going to go to the second supervisorial district, and we're going to just follow the line down the table here, if that's okay. We're going to interpret that as alphabetical, as it may be. And we're going to start with, first of all, the Honorable Frank Hager. Frank is a longtime member of the Fairfax Town Council, was mayor, I believe, on the council for 40 years, and more recently, he's been a member of the Marin Sonoma Control Board, and a member of the Ross Valley Sanitary District. Frank
Hager. Well, thank you, Dick. After years of the same old, it's time for the second district to have a real public advocate offering better solutions to the issues we all face today. I will bring grassroots politics, progressive leadership, and effective legislative experience to the Board of Supervisors. I provided grassroots leadership for 10 terms on the Fairfax Town Council, a 7-time mayor, and now I'm on the Ross Valley Sanitary District Board. The sewer district hit rock bottom in 2012, close to bankruptcy. It was a mess, and I worked almost full-time for 1 year riding the ship. I did not need a consultant during that time, tell me what to do. Today, the Rossley Sanitary District is on its road to recovery. We do not have to become San Jose North to have affordable housing. As mayor, I authored the ordinance that protected all Fairfax's affordable apartment housing, and I facilitated the approval of the 70-unit Bennett House, a low-income development for seniors and the disabled. Fairfax parks and open spaces, all of the commons, have been pesticide-free for the past 15 years. I wrote the law, including neighborhood notification. We must end the use of toxic pesticides on all county properties. Talk is cheap. I'll write the ordinance that makes it law. In 2008, Marin was going to be aerial sprayed with pesticides. As the San Francisco Bay Area coordinator to stop the spray for the light-brown Alpamore, we were successful in stopping the pesticide spray program statewide, not just Marin, statewide. Bringing mobile health care to the community with the formation of Ross Valley Paramedic Authority is one of my proudest accomplishments. And I would like to expand the emergency medical services we offer at our firehouses to include some hours where folks should come in to have their vitals checked, especially seniors. I authored Fairfax's living wage law and have long supported a $15 an hour minimum wage. I was a union president in the early 2000s, and I'm pleased that the state may be going in that direction. A living wage is key to affordable housing in Marin County. In 2004, I was one of the five sponsors of the grassroots GMO-free Marin initiative, directed directly at Monsanto. Voters passed it in Marin overwhelmingly. Marin County needs new leadership, and I have a track record of delivering change in innovative but practical ways. We need flood control policies that emphasize green infrastructure and respects parks and playgrounds. A pension policy that protects workers and taxpayers. A mental health policy that reaches families and streets, which includes implementation of Laura's Law. And we must end the reign of consultants. Much of that can be done in-house, saving millions of dollars. The county needs to accept responsibility for addressing homelessness and programs for homeless people and not make Santa Fe go alone. Santa Fe neighborhoods and businesses need help. I have worked to save the North Coast rivers for decades. We stopped the dam at Dos Rios on the Eel River. I have fought the water grab of the Metropolitan Water District of Southern California as co-founder of Friends of the Eel River and North Coast River.
Thank you, Frank Edgar.
I'll be able to finish it up.
Next up, as we go down the table in our quasi-alphabetical style, a member of the Larkspur City Council and a candidate in the 2nd District for the Board of Supervisors. You know the 2nd District is the Ross Valley and it streams all the way over to San Rafael. Kevin Harrell.
And I promise you, you won't need to get the cowbell out. And thanks, Dick. And thanks to. I'll pull it out.
I think it's turned on.
I want to thank Citizens for Sustainable Pension Plans tonight for hosting tonight's event, and to all the candidates who are joining us this evening. I got into this race last year because of concerns that I share with many of you in this room over the unprecedented pressure Marin County faces to accommodate regional growth and development. Too often, the response to these pressures has been the promotion of increasing levels of urbanization throughout the county, the worst example of which is the Wind Cup project in Corcadero. This has resulted in levels of traffic congestion that keep getting worse, threats to the integrity of our local water supply, and continuing assaults on Marin's visual and natural environment. Last year, I was grateful to receive the endorsement of CSPP in our campaign for the Board of Supervisors in District 2. In making that endorsement, CSPP showed their confidence in me as a candidate who was running not because of personal political aspirations, but because so many of our neighbors asked me to take up that challenge. I currently serve on the Larkspur City Council, along with colleagues like Larry Chu, who was an early advocate for responsible pension reform. Larry and I have worked together specifically to make sure the city is taking responsible steps to fund our other post-employee benefits liability to city employees. We appreciate the need for transparency in all aspects of government to ensure that taxpayers understand the nature of negotiations that encourage unfunded debt and threaten current core services. We recognize that the lack of transparency only encourages special interests to promote themselves through the issuance of new bonds and other assessments that increase the financial pressures on our county's shrinking middle class. I understand that public sector workers have legitimate interests at stake, contribute to our quality of life, and deserve a fair compensation package that is also fiscally responsible. That is one reason I specifically have focused on improving our city's ongoing funding of Larkspur's OPEB liability. We owe it to our public employees to make sure that their interests in a secure retirement are fully honored by the actions of our county's elected officials.
30 seconds.
I respect both of the other candidates who are running this year for District 2, but the challenges we face in Marin are complicated and beyond anything we've seen before. We need a new voice with the credentials and experience to confront those challenges thoughtfully and who is prepared to make sure that government decision making is done in a truly open and transparent way. I am prepared to be that new voice, and I respectfully ask all of you to support me in that effort. Thank you very much.
District, the incumbent supervisor is Supervisor Katie Rice. Supervisor Rice was a former administrative assistant, chief of staff, if you will, to the late Supervisor Hal Brown. She was appointed by Governor Jerry Brown to the seat and was elected in her own right and is now running for a second full term. Supervisor Rice.
Good evening. I'm sorry for running in like that at the last minute, but I made it just in time. Can you hear me now? Is that working?
Yes.
Okay. Thanks for having me here tonight. Thank you, CSPP, for hosting this tonight. I think it's a value not only to the public, but also to us as candidates, not only to listen to who we're running against, but also what's happening in the other districts. So I want to start out by saying it's really been an honor to represent and serve the residents of District 2 as supervisor these past 4 years. But my experience in public service and my commitment to this community did not begin when I was elected to office in 2012. I grew up here in Marin. I raised my 3 children here. I know what makes this county so special. Our values around open space protection, around the environment, children and family, and healthy, vibrant communities goes back decades and distinguishes us in this great place we call Marin. My work as supervisor is informed by these values and by 2 decades of community work, supporting schools, advocating for equity in education, working on local causes and campaigns that make our community stronger. As supervisor, I focus my attention on pressing issues, including combating traffic and congestion with the initiation of the Ross Valley Yellow Bus School Pilot, through the Sir Francis Drake Corridor Improvement Project, and by joining forces with local and state officials to secure funding and an accelerated timeline for reopening the third lane on the Richmond-San Rafael Bridge. In my first term, I've had successes also in both the environmental and public safety arenas. I've worked with neighbors and conservation groups to acquire permanently protect the beautiful Sky Ranch property. Under my leadership, the county established its parks and playgrounds and public buildings as pesticide-free. And I've helped to secure millions in funding to advance flood prevention efforts and improve our ability to detect and fight wildland fire. On the public health front, I've championed a sensible vaccine policy and led the effort to adopt a countywide drug take-back ordinance that requires pharmaceutical companies to fund and implement a drug take-back program as part of our battle against the opioid crisis. My top priorities going into a second term are again around traffic, fighting traffic, reducing congestion, improving transportation, and improving our roadway infrastructure as well.
30 seconds.
I'll continue to be vigilant about around environmental stewardship, open space protection, and advancing efforts to combat climate change. And addressing homelessness. This is a growing and serious issue here in Marin, and particularly in San Rafael. Finally, I'll be working to continue to improve communications at the county level, transparency, and community involvement in county government generally. Thank you for having this tonight, and I look forward with some trepidation to the rest of the evening.
Thank you very much. Anyway, we're moving over to the third district, which is basically Southern Marin County. And alphabetical again, we're going to start with Susan Kirsch. Susan has been successful in the private sector, but he's also now member of the Democratic Central Committee of Marin County and president of the Marin Coalition. Welcome.
Thank you. So
Remember the Chinese curse that says, may you live in interesting times? Part of my running for the Board of Supervisors is because it seems we're living in really interesting times. And the thing about interesting times is that they have both the possibility of risk and threat on the one hand, or we have the possibility of opportunity and thriving on the other hand. So I come into this race with a commitment to see how my participation can add to the thriving for Marin County, and especially for the Southern District. So I want to talk about three pillars of my campaign. I'm really not going back into much of my background, but I want to talk about the pillars of my campaign and why I think they're important. And I'll name the three pillars, and then I'll give some examples of them. You know, the first pillar is that I think too often we've had decision-making happening behind closed doors, and my commitment is to be able to have greater transparency. Too often, we've had decisions that have meant our money is not being used wisely. My commitment is to bring greater fiscal accountability to the work that the Board of Supervisors is doing. And third, too often, citizen participation from groups like CSPP or groups like the Civil Grand Jury has been dismissed or disregarded. And my commitment is to be able to increase both the engagement and the empowerment of citizen groups to have a voice in what's happening in our county. So let me give you a couple of examples of why this is important and what's been happening. In terms of the failure to have an open door, open policy, kind of the gold standard of operating with openness is the Brown Act. And within the last 6 months, our Board of Supervisors was found guilty by the Marin Superior Court of violating the Brown Act as they were considering the housing element. So we need greater transparency. On the issue of expending money in a way that seems out of alignment with what much of the language is of the Board of Supervisors, I was there at the last hearings around considering what the budget is going to be in 2016-2017. So in the capital improvement category, there is $21 million allocated for the roof, but no money allocated for Marin City and the $16 million of deferred maintenance. In the category of citizen engagement, I'd like to see more with honoring the work of grand jury, Citizen Marin, Citizens for Stable Pensions, and that engaging in those three things means that living in interesting times mean we have a greater opportunity to embrace positive change.
And the third district incumbent supervisor is Supervisor Kate Sears. Kate Sears is a Sausalito resident, and she is a former senior deputy attorney general, but an attorney in the private sector as well, and perhaps is the only candidate for office this year that speaks Chinese. Supervisor Sears.
Thank you very much, Dick, and lucky for all of you, I've really forgotten my Mandarin, so I won't go there. But I do want to start off on a personal note a little bit. My family moved to Marin County 60 years ago. We moved to Mavalley in 1955 and then to Sausalito in 1965. I went to kindergarten in Tam Valley. I went to Marin Country Day School and then Tam High class of 1969. I really, truly am a daughter of this community. I served in the Sausalito Planning Commission for 5.5 years, and I headed up a couple of citywide resident task forces in Sausalito, one of which, the public safety, the fire and safety buildings that you see today in Sausalito are the result of the work of one of those task forces that I headed up. I'm deeply embedded in this community, and I know what our values are, and I share those values. Before becoming a supervisor, I was a lawyer for 22 years. 16 of those years were in private practice, the last six at the California Attorney General's office. I spent those years going after people who were ripping off consumers. I'm very proud to have been the lead lawyer in the first lawsuit that was filed against Countrywide Bank for predatory lending that resulted in the first nationwide settlement for $8.6 billion. That was a lot of fun. But I gave that up to become your county supervisor, and I've been your supervisor for about 5 years now, 5 years in June. And I've really been busy. So I've spent a lot of time working on traffic issues, particularly trying to address traffic at Tam Junction and in Muir Woods. I'm also working closely with Caltrans and the city of Mill Valley on short-term and long-term solutions for the East Blythedale 101 Tiburon Boulevard overcrossing that's particularly thorny traffic-wise. I'm particularly excited about the collaboration that I'm engaged in with the city of Mill Valley and the Mill Valley School District to launch a yellow school bus pilot project. And I'm continuing to work with Tiburon and Belvedere and the Reed School District to make sure that their yellow school bus program continues. It's been phenomenally successful in alleviating traffic on the Tiburon-Belvedere Peninsula. I also chair Marin Clean Energy, and in the last 5 years, we have absolutely gone gangbusters in expanding our service. We're now over 170,000 customers in Marin and Napa counties and in Richmond. We're also developing solar energy projects right here in Marin. You can't get any more local than that in terms of the location of your renewable energy. And we're promoting energy efficiency programs. I've been a leader in raising awareness of the impact of sea level rise, and I've been working hard to protect our environment and the health of our communities by inserting a no toxics clause into the MOU between the county and the National Park Service and by convincing Marin Housing Authority to stop using glyphosate at all of its properties. I've worked hard with my colleagues on the board to responsibly pay down our retiree pension and health obligations. We've made $94 million in discretionary health payments since 2012, 2013. My mom grew up on a farm, and so I'm really familiar with the sound of the bell. And I look forward to talking more about all these issues with you going forward.
Thank you, Supervisor. We're going to move to the sprawling 4th District, and it goes forever. It starts in west of the city of Novato. The western portion of the city of Novato goes down the coast to Point Reyes Station, comes in to take places like Lagunitas. They're always looking for populations about a redistricting thing. It comes around and with a little corridor, the city of Corte Madera, it's a town of Corte Madera, excuse me, is in the boundaries and of the canal in San Rafael. And that there's 4,000 people who will not vote in San Quentin that are in that district, and that's Homestead Valley, along with West Marin in the Millville. So we're going to do our alphabetical training. Alex Easton-Brown ran for the State Assembly previously. He's a sociologist. He's been extremely involved in Marin public policy issues for decades. Alex Easton-Brown.
Thank you. We have too much traffic, too much development. We have a board of supervisors out of touch. We need a culture change at Civic Center where the regional agencies and developers and consultants no longer call the shots. We need to dismantle the MTC rather than let them squander our bridge tolls and our tax dollars. We are not Pleasanton. We are not Roanoke Park. We are not San Ramon. We are Marin. And they are not going to trample on our uniqueness, on our beauty, on our character with their one-size-fits-all mandates. The supervisors waste billions on consultants, yet the roads go unpaved. They just approved $98,000 for a consultant to study the sedimentation on my road. If they would spend $98,000 on asphalt and pave my road, there would be no sedimentation to study. We need a cap on the pensionable pay of our county employees. I suggest a cap of $80,000. Teachers, in comparison, receive less than half that amount. Pensions should be a safety net, like Social Security, not a windfall, like winning a lottery ticket. We need Laura's Law, because without it, we can't even begin to solve our homeless problem. We should no longer tolerate the filth, the broken syringes on our sidewalks and in our parks. We have a right to clean, non-threatening civic environment. Yet the supervisors let their staff kill Laura's Law because it was too much work, too much trouble. Once again, the supervisors defer to their county staff. They abdicate their leadership. Once again, the tail wags the dog. As a parent, I cannot begin to tell you of the grief and heartbreak of seeing your child on the streets, homeless, at risk because of drugs and alcohol. Yet without Laura's Law, it is impossible to intercede. The supervisors need to recognize the sad spectacle which is right in front of their eyes and which constitutes the stubborn core of our homeless problem. Thank you.
Easton-Brown, thank you. I should have mentioned that there is no incumbent in the 4th District. This is the district currently represented for the past 19 and a half years by Supervisor Steve Kinsey, who has chosen not to run for re-election this time. Going back to the 4th District candidates, in line from Novato, Al Duggan. Al is a recently retired, senior insurance company executive and has become extremely involved in Novato public policy issues. Al.
Al Duggan, I believe I'm very highly qualified for the key issues that are facing Marin moving forward. We all value Marin's small-time, suburban, rural character, and we don't want it to become like Walnut Creek in the East Bay with all the things that come with it. Overdevelopment undermines what we treasure most with Marin, overwhelms our roads, schools, and resources. Intolerable traffic congestion and excess development, which are inextricably linked, will adversely impact all of Marin residents, rich and poor. We need to make sure that the regional planning for housing is in line with the general plans of all the jurisdictions. I have completed extensive research on ABAG methodologies, and I have directly engaged with the chief economist at ABAG and the assistant director of the HCD responsible for housing allocation certification. ABAG has adopted two important recommendations I made in the 2013 plan, and myself with the group were the first to get a Marin jurisdiction, Novato, to have reduced density for the housing element. I will work to get realistic traffic and public transportation solutions for the region. Nothing is more precious to all Marin residents than our health and protection of our environment. I will work with the citizens of Marin to preserve our parks and trails, and I will eliminate the use of toxic herbicides such as Roundup in our county. We need to ensure that Marin is fiscally sound and sustainable for the future. The retiree unfunded liability as of March 2016 is $638 million. In the next 5 years, there's a large number of county employees that are eligible for retirement with the highest total compensation packages from the old days. There are also serious challenges to meeting the 7.25 return goal. We also have in 2018-2019, the general fund is projected to have a budget deficit. I believe my past training and professional experience in financial reviews and analytical analysis will benefit the board.
30 seconds.
We need to protect our open spaces, and I support the ranchers in Marin. In fact, with the Berkeley study on reduction in carbon, we can be proactive in reducing carbon working with the rancher. And then finally, one issue is tied to every issue. We need real transparency and public engagement. We need to have the decisions made at the council level be engaged with the proper public involvement and not rely solely on third-party consultants and special interests. Thank you very much.
Tomas Kaselonis is has been a member in the past of the Novato Fire Protection Board. He's the proper term is disaster supervisor, safety supervisor, and very active with the Coast Guard and with life-saving operations really throughout Marin County. Pleasure to have you. Come on.
Hi, good evening, everybody. My name is Tomas Papadis Kaselonis. I am running for District 4, obviously. And since we only have a few minutes, and I think you're going to hear a lot of our responses to questions that you have, I have a website, tomas4marin.com, where I'm constantly posting my thoughts and observations about many of these subjects. I actually do training and professional development, and you're probably only going to remember about 10%. So I'm actually going to introduce myself to you, and then hopefully you'll hear my answers this evening to many of your questions. So since January 2001, I started to protect and serve the country in the U.S. Coast Guard Reserves, followed on by protecting against terrorist attacks with TSA. And then in 2008, I joined the Federal Emergency Management Agency. In addition to my two jobs, starting in 2008, I volunteered for the Marin County Hazardous Materials Team as a volunteer, and then from 2011 to 2015, I was elected to the Board of Directors on the Nevada Fire District. I'm first-generation American-Lithuanian, and my first language was not English. I was born in Southern California and moved to the Bay Area in 2001. I opened my first business at 12, ran my first million-dollar restaurant at 19, and then managed a $150 million per year contract by 26. And if you're asking, I'm now 40. I know what it's like to be on welfare. I've been homeless twice in my life, and I know the meaning of a hard day's work. I'm not a perfect man, nor free from mistakes, but I read voraciously and driven to learn from my experiences. I am, as they say in the Coast Guard, a jack of all trades, but I am considered a subject matter expert in environmental hazardous materials and disaster response. Ideas are nothing without action. I embody action with dedication and feverish output. I will not question out of spite or petty antics, and I am willing to give you my observations before my opinion until I feel confident about the facts. I have been held accountable for people's lives from the East Coast to the South Pacific, and I have broad shoulders to carry that burden. I'm running for Marin County Supervisor because I believe that leadership in government is lacking, and that Marin deserves a hell of a lot more than it's currently getting. Thank you.
Thank you, Tomas. Our next candidate is from the 4th District again, and this time it is Dominic Grossi, who is a rancher, business owner, and very active with the MALT, the Marin Agricultural Land Trust. Dominic, please go ahead.
Thank you, Dick, and thank you to CSPP for putting on this event this evening. As Dick mentioned, I am a rancher. I'm a fourth generation dairyman. Our family has been here in Marin County for about 120 years. I'm deeply rooted in what we have in Marin County and appreciate and respect what we have in West Marin. And seeing that protected is extremely important to me. So I want to be able to continue those traditions that were started by Gary Giacomini and continued with Supervisor Kinsey before us. Over the years, I've been very involved specifically with our ag community, but also beyond that with our county, serving on our Regulatory Improvement Advisory Committee several years ago, and including a tax expenditure working group that the county put up when they were looking to put forth Measure A. And so I got a chance to work on that and work closely with the county. In addition to that, as Dick mentioned, I've served 6 years on the MALT board, and I have also served now for the past 11 years on the Farm Bureau board. And it's with Farm Bureau that I got extremely involved with policy down here in the county, working on the countywide plan, the local coastal plan, and there's many, many aspects of that plan that were simply against ranching. And so I fought very hard to protect what the ranchers had in the LCP. I was able to incorporate language known as intergenerational housing that never existed before in the local coastal plan, and now it does, assuming we can get it passed through the Coastal Commission. But this is something very important to me. The ranchers will have the ability to live on their ranches. Right now, the coastal zone only allows one home on each parcel. And so with this, children who want to stay involved in agriculture would be able to do that. And so that's something I was very proud of. And some of my other priorities, I look to the Inland Corridor. And we've heard everyone mention the huge problems we have with traffic and affordable housing. So I think there's infrastructure issues that we need to be dealt with. I think we need to build relationships with Sonoma County because a great deal of our traffic issue and congestion starts in Sonoma. They've grown by leaps and bounds in terms of the number of stations up there compared to how we have grown in Marin. So we need to build that relationship. We need to work with them to find out where we can get some good parking to get people to start carpooling and take public transit from Sonoma so they're not even getting onto our streets. Maybe we need to find incentives, but we need to start opening up that dialogue with Sonoma County. Above that, with affordable housing, this has become a huge issue throughout Marin. It leads right, as we've heard people mention before already, has to do with not having enough in Marin, but we are mandated to get some built. And we need to look to innovative ideas. Lily Pad Homes, Rachel Guinness, started the idea of junior second units. I think that's a great opportunity for us to start creating affordable housing for people that don't want to rent an entire house or a whole apartment. They can find a room. So I'm very supportive of those kinds of ingenious ideas that will create new affordable housing for people. I think that the possibility of creating affordable housing on some of the ag lands, a small 750 square foot house, certainly is not going to be huge development, and so I would like to see that policy changed out in West Marin as well. Thank you.
Dominic, thank you. Next candidate is Wendy Kallins. Wendy is from Lagunitas. Did I get that right?
Yeah,
Forest Knolls. Forest Knolls, Lagunitas, and Woodacre metropolitan area.
That's how we see it.
Yeah, I know. And is the founder and executive director of Safe Routes to Schools, which is an pioneering effort to get children to schools via non-motor transportation. Wendy, it's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you very much for allowing us to have this forum tonight. I'm very proud of the policy experience that I would bring to the Board of Supervisors. My passion for sustainable living and protecting our open space and local agriculture includes decades of experience on a wide range of policy, advocacy, fiscal, and educational issues. This district requires someone who has experience in a broad range of issues. Over the last 30 years, I have been involved in such issues as diverse as transportation, land use, housing, open space, health, safety, environmental protection, climate change, just to name a few. I've assembled funding packages, managed a budget, and written grants. A lot of people like to talk about transportation. It's kind of like the weather. Everyone talks about it. Nobody can do anything about it. I am the one candidate on this side of the table that has actually done something to reduce traffic congestion. For the past 17 years, as founder and program coordinator for the Marin Safe Routes to Schools, I've brought together people to find solutions to the complicated traffic challenges that we encounter at 58 of our schools in Marin County. When I first started Safe Routes to Schools, nobody was talking to each other. The parents who wanted their kids to walk and bike to school were angry because it wasn't safe. The Public Works Department and the cities didn't want to have to deal with it, and the schools didn't think transportation was their problem. Now we have an institutionalized program and everybody sits at the table and we are working to resolve this problem. We have brought in over $30 million worth of improvements around our schools for safety improvements and reducing local traffic congestion. We've gone from, we now have 50% of our children taking what we call green transportation to school, and in many of our middle schools, over half of the children now walk and bike to school. I've also been fighting for the environment, sustainability, and protecting our open space. I'm on the executive committee of Marin's Sustainable Marin, and working with my neighbors, and this is how I cut my teeth, we helped to limit what would have been massive development on the ridgelines to something that is now 1,100 acres of open space and only a handful of homes. And then later in the 90s, I again worked with my community group, and we were again able to limit development and reduce the size of homes and protect another 450 acres of open space. I've worked on many different transportation issues. I helped to pass the transit ballot tax in 2004, and I worked on the smart train and pathway measure in 2008. I've been talking to residents around this district, and it's very clear that we need a supervisor who's committed to protecting the integrity of our communities. We need strong local representation that has a balanced approach, that not only can work with big issues like traffic and housing, but also know that we have 20 distinct little communities that need our attention, and a ranching community that needs our protection. Thank you.
Next candidate in the fourth supervisorial district hails from the metropolis of Olima. He's the president and founder of Rodoni Construction Company. Dennis Rodoni is an elected member of the North Marin Water District Board and has been on that board for a good 15 years or so. Dennis is a candidate in the 4th District. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Good evening. Dick, thank you so much.
All right, that better?
Yes.
Anyway, good evening. Thank you, CSPP, for having the event tonight. But most of all, I want to congratulate all the candidates tonight for the commitment to this election. It's a big job, and I want to congratulate you all for being here. And Dick, thank you very much for your inspiring opinions. Thank you, Dick, for inspiring us with your columns in the IJ.
I'm Dennis Rodoni. I reside in Olema with my wife of 37 years, Judy. I'm a West Marin native, was raised in Point Reyes Station, attended local schools, and graduated from Chico State University with an honors degree in economics. For over 34 years, I've managed and owned Rodoni Construction Company. I'm not the president, we're not incorporated, it's a sole proprietorship, specializing in custom remodels in West Marin. Prior to that, I was a high school teacher. And for over 35 years, I've worked to make my community a better place. The last 21 years, I've been a board member of the North Marin Water District, where I worked on water issues in West Marin and Novato. I've also served on committees and advised the Sonoma County Water Agency on water issues in the North Bay, and specifically Marin County. I was a special district representative on LAFCO, the Local Agency Formation Commission, for 14 years, where I worked on city and special districts, spheres of influence, and annexations. I have worked many jobs and on many boards in the nonprofit world, ranging from the Coastal Health Alliance, where I worked on healthcare issues, the West Marin Senior Services, where I chaired the search committee for finding and funding an assisted living facility in Point Reyes Station. I'm proud to say that the West Marin seniors now own their own facility and provide assisted living for 8 people in West Marin. I chaired the Point Reyes National Seashore during an important time when the seashore managed and contracted for the Giacomini wetland restoration. A very proud moment in my lifetime because I grew up on 3rd Street right next to the wetlands. I've also been on the Tomas Bay Association Board of Directors, which protects Tomas Bay and its watershed.
30 seconds.
Thank you. You have my personal commitment that as your supervisor, I will insist on open and transparent government. Being accessible as an elected official is important to me. Holding office hours in the district is important. I'll protect our environment and small town way of life, oppose unwanted high density development, reduce traffic congestion with a promise not to make it worse. Keep county government on a sound financial footing, address the adverse effects of climate change, sea level rise, and reduce our carbon footprint. Defend Marin's parks, open space, and agricultural heritage. Thank you.
Thank you. Brian Staley is a construction manager, planner, designer, and builder from Woodacre. He is also the chair of the San Geronimo Valley, the nonprofit San Geronimo Valley Planning Group. Brian.
Thank you very much. I'm a third generation Californian. I grew up in San Anselmo and consider myself incredibly lucky to live in this community. I have an enormous amount of experience working with environmental groups, and have been very active in the environmental community for just about 30 years. I have had an enormous opportunity to work with a great many people on a great number of issues that that cover everything from planning to design review to you name it. What I'd like to do is I'd like to talk about a couple of things in terms of new regulations that are coming. One of them was mentioned by Dominic. I think it's very important to note, although that there are some positive aspects of the local coastal program, I think there are some very concerning aspects of it as well. There are, as a general list, the proposal itself, as it's currently written, would allow for repurposing of ranch land without environmental review. It allows for basically a complete lack of environmental review if one of these ranches, or if a ranch decides to become a vineyard, and also allows for 5,000 square feet of additional processing, as well as Dominic had mentioned, allows for a second and second homes, as well as granny units or in-law units. All told, Given the total amount of square footage, we're talking about potentially 1.5 million new square feet of development in West Marin. West Marin currently has a traffic problem. It's a little different from the traffic problem along the corridor. It's more tourist traffic, but if you can imagine 1.3 or 1.5 million additional square feet, the number of people and the amount of traffic that would generate is quite surprising and quite dramatic. It'll occur fairly quickly given the adoption process, and if the Coastal Commission does approve it, we'll be seeing changes rather quickly. Another new regulation that California has recently adopted is a piece of legislation called AB 885, and this essentially the state has designated most of our waterways and our creeks as impaired, and as a result, the regulations that will be imposed on the 4th District will be extensive. What I'd like to do as a supervisor is work with the community, work with ranchers to allow them the tools that they need in order to do their job, but also protect our community from excessive development and enormous amount of traffic.
Staley, thank you. And the final candidate for the 4th District, I'm sorry, by alphabetical, but when we finish, you'll be the first in the, when we come up at the end, after concluding the statement, is Marin Matt Tamburo. Marin is from Homestead Valley, which as most folks know is the unincorporated portion of Mill Valley, that somehow found itself in the 4th Supervisor. Marin is a singer, songwriter, and homemaker, and the independent journal said that she had volunteered, that if she's elected, she volunteered to sing the national anthem before the Board of Supervisors meeting, but she also added, I won't push it. All right.
Thanks, Mr. Spotswood, and it's Mary with an I. Thank you for inviting us and having this event this evening. I'm very impressed by everyone's background, and I'm definitely feeling like the underdog in this race, but I think what Marin County needs right now in the 4th District is someone that has a fresh perspective, and I think that person is me for several reasons. Some of the background, I'm more than a homemaker. In 2007, I was on the board of the Social Enterprise Alliance and helped form the San Francisco chapter of that. If you're not familiar with social enterprise, it's a conscious capitalism that has a business structure to raise money for nonprofit causes. I also helped my husband manage the plant studios in Sausalito during a very difficult, challenging time, and we received the Golden Spire Award from Marin County in, I think it was 2007. And what motivates me to seek the Marin County District Board Supervisor position is a desire to just serve the community. I've seen a lack of respect for our citizens' civil rights, a fair process, and I was thrust into the middle of a quagmire in 2010 when we received a letter from Marin County about a seemingly innocuous Sacred to School project on our street. And we went to a meeting and found out that there was a project in planning for 4 years before any of us found out about it. And as I delved deeper into the situation, I discovered systemic issues, not the least of which were a complete disregard for our local community plan, the Tamalpais Area Design Plan, which states we do not incur sidewalks, curbs, and gutters in the planning area, and a categorical exemption of CEQA. So despite fighting this project vociferously and trying to work and bring people together, politics trumped honesty. We found some false information in the application that was awarded the grant funding, and the sidewalk was built, and now we have about an average of 1 million gallons of polluted stormwater runoff running into a creek that contains federally protected species of fish. So I'm also concerned.
30 seconds.
Okay, I'm concerned about the growing divide in Marin, especially as it pertains to income inequality and opportunity. So I'm going to work very hard on increasing equity in Marin, and I grew up in HUD housing in New Jersey. I've lived in San Francisco Bay Area for 24 years, and the last 16 of those in Marin County. And thank you very much.
All right, thank you. election is a first round election. So in two of these districts, the third district is only two candidates, so that'll be it. One of them will be the winner, the loser, and they'll be happily go on with the rest of their summer. In the fourth district in particular, it is the top two candidates of all the eight candidates that are in the race so far. So there'll be a runoff for sure at this number mathematically in November. So it's a top two system. Same thing applies in the second supervisorial district. Someone needs to get 50%. If they don't, the top two candidates run off in November. So just so you know the process. The first question tonight, and the first three questions, are going to come from our sponsoring organization. They said before, that's traditional group of the sponsor. The traditional group of sponsor, they get to ask a question, two or three. And the first question, here's how we're going to answer them, by the way. We're going to start over with Al. Then we're going to start right here with Al. And then
they'll be able to
And what we're going to do is we're going to pass it down. I'm going to stand here just to get you going for 30 seconds and then go back and forth. The quicker the better, if you can, if it's easy, please, please respect that so we can get as many questions as possible. We'll start with Al, and then we just go down the line, and then we're going to come back over here, and Alex will be next, and we'll go that way. On question number one, which is as follows. Over 100 county retirees receive pensions in excess of $100,000, including some whose pensions are more than the salaries of the workers who replace them. Most of them also receive retiree health subsidies in excess of $12,000, ranging to more than $20,000 as well. Question, now, should the health subsidies for these high-end pension recipients be continued? I'll do it.
Well, if you take a look at the way the pension system was set up, the health care...
Can we have the candidates stand up so we know what they look like, please?
Sure, sorry. Got it? You know, one of the big issues with the pension plan is the ability to come and add vacation time and stack additional costs onto the top of the final salary. So just from the start, we've got to look at that because, you know, there's no way in the world in the private sector that you could do that. And as far as healthcare, I think, you know, down the road, we're gonna have to look and see if that will be adjusted in some kind of way because in the end, we have to be sustainable.
Come on.
So on the board of directors, I see the OPEB liability, and if you're following, you know that in the county it exceeds the pension liability, and for Nevada Fire it's more than double the pension liability. So we're going to have to innovate, and unfortunately my attempt to try and innovate during contract negotiations didn't work out right. So, but we have to find new ways of being able, not only for our retirees, but our current healthcare. The healthcare costs are compounded. We've seen over 14% increase from last year, and if we don't figure out a way to innovate for how to deliver healthcare services, that liability will continue to fold on itself.
Say again?
Say yes or no question.
Well, it's a much more complex issue. You can't just say yes or no to that answer.
Thank you, Tomas. Dominic.
Actually, you can say yes, and I will. I think if you're over the $120,000 point on your pensions that you're receiving, then we should start talking about pulling back on what we give in health care for those guys. Because they're at least able to pay for it already. They've got enough money in the bank. You know, there's a lot of other points that goes with regards to pension reform, though. To flat out eliminate the healthcare, I think we could do that only on the higher ones. Only about 4% of everybody that right now is receiving or that is retired is receiving that much money.
Wendy, healthcare.
So most of the people who are receiving these higher pensions, they either come from management or they come from public safety, and I think we need to separate the two. People who work in public safety put their lives on the line and often experience injuries and health issues related to the job. I don't think it's fair to take health benefits away from people who need it the most.
The most. Oh no, we already crossed, excuse me.
Thank you. It's a yes and no question. I don't mean to evade it, but I wanted to say that we have obligations to the county employees. Some of them are in the management level, but most of them are in the rank and file, and they're not earning that kind of money that we're talking about in this case.
I was one of the two board members at my district that voted against a pay raise for our general manager because he was planning to retire within a year. And I didn't even want the perception that we were spiking his wages. And I will take that to the Board of Supervisors.
Thank you. Brian.
I'm extremely concerned that we're basically talking about a majority of the individuals who are on pensions right now are making only between $30,000 and $40,000 at the most. If we're using the tools to bring them in and negotiate down, which is one of the main means of dealing with people on pensions right now, if we're negotiating them to have make less or receive less, then essentially what we're doing is we're taking our lunches from them. And I think that's inappropriate. Granted, there are some individuals who make $100,000, and we can talk about that, but most do not.
Mary.
I think we need to look at that by a case-by-case basis, and depending upon what sort of other health care is available to them, as our country is actually going through health care reform right now. I think we need to look at that as a total package.
Alex.
No, I think we should discontinue the health care. I don't want to sound cruel, but you know these public safety guys, they live and work hazardly while they're working, but once they retire, there's nothing hazardous about retirement. So I don't think they should be paid that extra chunk once they're retired. In fact, teachers only get a 2% retirement factor. Public safety people get 3%. That really adds up. That's a multiplier based on their wage. And I think we ought to get rid of the 3% category for management and public safety. Okay, sir.
Thank you very much. So I think as many of you know, in 2013, the county created a retiree health trust fund that's created over $50 million in savings as of 2015 and fully funds our retiree health liabilities going forward. We also, the state adopted TEPRA in 2013, which caps benefits that retirees can get. These are new hires as of January 1st of 2013. There's limits on what you can do, as I'm sure you know, under California Supreme Court law with existing retirees. But beyond that, I think it's very important to look at the impact on our county employees. We may have a third of our employees retiring in the next 5 years. We need to be able to recruit and retain quality employees. Most of our employees earn very little in their retirement, and we don't want to lose them. This is a competitive hiring challenge.
There's a curve.
So the question is whether the people making over $100,000 a year should have their medical subsidies discontinued. I think the answer to that is yes. And I just want to point out that for someone who retires with $100,000 a year, if they live 25 years in their retirement, that's going to be an expense of $2.5 million for that one person. And these 625 people who have retired with $100,000 or more is going to cost over that 25-year period $1.5 billion.
I think it's a key, as a couple of speakers have pointed out, we have contracts we've entered into with past, with in earlier tiers of county employees that bind us to providing them a certain level of retirement and health care after they retire. Going forward, that's where we've been working, is working with our employees, working with labor, to come up with retirement packages, including health care that's reasonable, keeps them covered, but is sustainable fiscally for both the employer and the retiree. So it's critical that we keep our employees covered, offer reasonable health coverage, but we need to all work together to make sure they're financially sustainable going forward.
Katie, thank you. Kevin.
Thank you, Katie. I appreciate the comments about some of the contractual constraints that exist on what we can do in terms of pensions, and health benefits. I will remind folks one of the reasons we're here today is to call into question, frankly, some of those arrangements that have been made over the years. There are actually some very serious legal questions that have been raised by the group that is hosting this event tonight about whether or not those contractual arrangements are legal. I come from the private sector. I think it's important for us to start moving in the direction that the private sector has been adhering to now for years and years and years, which is to move away from subsidizing benefits for new people where we don't have established contractual arrangements.
Frank.
Healthcare. It's not just a Marin issue, it's a statewide issue. Billions in unfunded healthcare liability. We're all facing it. The cities, the counties, the special district. How are we going to deal with it? One way, only one way. Statewide, universal health care, single payer. That's the solution. We need it. Statewide. No way we can't bail out. We can't bail out of it. The cities can't bail out of it. Statewide, universal health care, single payer. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. Next CSPP question, and in an absolutely arbitrary fashion, I'm going to start this time with Susie Kirsch, and then work this way around to Frank, and end up with Katie. We'll have this be like one of those games you play when you're 100. Exactly. Next question, Susie Kirsch. Do you think public employee compensation ought to be reflective of compensation in the private sector? Would you commit to working toward that goal in labor negotiations?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank
you.
Thank
you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank
you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Out in the world, and we're concerned about equity issues and fair pay issues. So that is something that we are already attuned to.
Alex.
Comparable pay is a scam to lift all their boats at our expense. You see a board of directors, and one guy says 100,000, the other guy says, well, 103, then 106, 107. Well, it's all comparable, it's all in the neighborhood. But that's how these things escalate, these pays escalate. I'm totally against comparable pay, I think it's a ripoff.
The private sector ended in 1991-92 the full pension. We got to deal with the fact that moving forward, and they did that because they couldn't afford to do it. And so moving forward, we have to deal with the same reality. And I would say, yes, we have to make it comparable to private sector.
Come on.
So going back, if you read one of my recent posts, it costs you $140,000 a year to live in Marin. So the $100,000 statement, how people pay, I've done a comparison at the fire district. They get paid a heck of a lot more than anywhere else in the rest of the state. So I believe comparisons are true, but whether or not it's in fact the private sector, I'm not entirely sold on that yet.
Don.
Yeah, I'm not certain that the public employees should get exactly what you're getting in the private sector. Maybe we can make them comparable, but your private sector is doing very different jobs depending on what they're doing and how much money they're generating for the companies that they work for. And so you might get slightly less pay working here in the public system, but then you're going to get that pension. And as I just alluded to, the private sector has eliminated pensions to a certain extent because they couldn't afford it. But that pension then becomes, you know, the reason you want to go and work for the public sector. Is going to help you when you're done working.
Wendy.
I think we need to be aware of broad statements, because if we're looking in the private sector, what the CEOs make, which is in the millions and millions of dollars, I don't think that's what we want to be paying our top management. So I think we have to, you know, be looking very carefully. We also have a lot of people in the private sector not making enough money to live on. And we want to be able to attract good people. So I don't think it's a fair comparison.
Dennis.
Thank you. I think it's important that we recognize that we negotiate in good faith with our whoever we're negotiating with. And I'd like to add one aspect to the whole program is that I like looking at total compensation, which includes wages and retirement. So when you're doing good comparison, I'm one of the few board members that asks for total compensation being looked at, because I think that's an important comparison that we need to do. Again, I think that this is all done in negotiation in good faith, and that's important too. Thank you.
Brian?
I think the comparison to some extent is a hyperbole. I believe that in many cases we're talking about regulators and individuals who have unique, unique qualifications that are not found in the private sector. So for the most part, many of the individuals who work at the county and work in the public sector are simply, there is no comparison.
Mary.
Yeah, I'll just mirror that. We're talking apples and oranges here. We can't really compare to other areas because Marin is unique and our cost of living is higher. If we want to reduce traffic by having people live and work in Marin, then we have to give them a comparable wage. And same thing goes with teachers. Teachers in the private sector make a lot more than our public school teachers, so I would like to raise those salaries.
Frank.
Thank you. Thank you. Management salaries need. Is that on?
No,
it's not on.
It was not on.
Is it on now?
No.
Okay. Management salaries need to be reeled in. As a Central Marin Sanitation Agency commissioner, this year we voted on salary increases. The general manager there makes $235,000 a year and manages 40 employees. He received a 3% pay raise and a 5% bonus. I voted against the bonus. I was the only board member out of six that voted against the bonus. I don't think we should be giving our highly paid administrative employees bonuses. You know, they're doing a good job, they keep their job. They don't need bonuses.
Thank you, Frank. It is important to make distinctions between different categories of employees. Like Kate, I'm also on the board of NC Clean Energy. It's important for us to be able to attract people to that organization with salaries that they could otherwise earn out in the marketplace. So in the right circumstances, that's absolutely appropriate. My problem is in taking into account market considerations for setting salaries for government employees. I look at some folks within our county government and they're making way too much money. I'm a lawyer, I practiced law for 35 years, and I look at what Steve Woodside is making. He's making a heck of a lot more money than I did for about 4 years in a row in these last 5 years. That's not market compensation, that's extortion.
A great idea of comparable pay for comparable positions between the private sector and the public sector, but as others have pointed out, be careful what you wish for scenario. For instance, I'm thinking about engineers, our civil engineers, and the wages and compensation. They're provided in the public sector at the county compared to out in the private sector. All that said, I think just as we look at comps within our comparable counties in the public sector, we can look in the private sector as well, and there are positions that translate. But let's be sure this shouldn't be a race to the bottom. This should be about providing fair compensation and making sure that people are earning a living wage so they can sustain their life.
Thank you, Kenny. Next question is the last one from the sponsoring group. And since you went last time, you got to go first this time, and we'll reverse that whole order. We can next time Kevin come around and we'll end up with Al. Okay? Consolidated, that's what we're doing. The great question, and this is a long question, and it might merit a short answer. The Grand Jury's Pension Enhancement Report last year recommended the appointment of a Citizens Pension Oversight Committee. Question, should the Board of Supervisors appoint a Citizen Pension Oversight Committee comprised of resident taxpayers who would A, review pension funding levels in light of the county's ability to pay, 2, review proposed pension changes before final county approval of any collective bargaining agreement, 3, review the county's compliance with the government codes related to pensions, and 4, develop a written quarterly report to the public as to the financial security of the pension plan. Basic question is, should they follow through with the grand jury's recommendation of a Citizen Pension Oversight Committee? Katie?
I would say no, as you phrased it, because I think that you've elected us as county supervisors and in the different public bodies to do all those things with the input of the public in a decent and thorough public process.
And Kevin?
I would say yes. I think that the recommendations of the civil grand jury are appropriate, right on target. I think we have a track record with this in this county, with the Board of Supervisors making decisions about pensions going forward that has been not transparent,
that has not involved the public in a reasonable way, and I think it's important to have an oversight mechanism established in order to provide oversight that is reasonable, serious, and public.
I'd like to see more citizen committees to assist the Board of Supervisors in a number of areas, not just pensions, a number of areas. And so my answer would be yes. I also believe that the Board of Supervisors should be taken out of the county pension system. You know, they took out the state legislators, assembly members and senators in 1990. They're not in PERS, they're not in the state retirement system. And we should take Marin County Supervisors out of this system, also out of the county system. Thank you.
Well, I like the idea of oversight, but I've also seen that there's criticism whenever the board appoints a committee. So they're appointing the committee. What's the difference? I think CSPP is doing a pretty good job of oversight.
Right. I think the whole function of the pension plan is to be able to have a tool to attract qualified individuals. And the main problem that we've had historically with a pension plan is that the supervisors, unfortunately, historically have avoided dealing with setting aside the proper funds in order to fund it. I don't see how a committee would force supervisors to set aside funding. I think it's just something the supervisors have a responsibility to do.
Dennis?
I would say no to that question, the way it's worded. And the reason being is that I think it's my job as supervisor to negotiate with the unions, to negotiate with the employees, and I don't want to pass it on to someone else. That's my job. I shouldn't be there if I wanted to let the citizens do all that. And I think you have other things you may want to do too. Having said that, I have great respect for the grand jury, and it'd be our responsibility to respond to them in a way that we at least try and satisfy their concern. And I think we need to do that as a board of supervisors. Thank you.
I think there are many instances where it's good to have a citizens oversight committee in order to assure that our tax money is being spent the way it should be. This is not one of those cases. I think the last thing we want is for a citizen committee to be involved in collective bargaining. I think that's absolutely inappropriate.
Dominic?
Yeah, and I would agree with what was just said for the most part, because the citizen advisory committee, I don't think it would be their job. It is the supervisor's job. And we have council that is supposed to be actually doing the negotiating, and supervisors should be on top of what's going on. They should be in the loop. They should be talking to, doing the collective bargaining, not necessarily sitting in the room, but they should be aware of everything going on already. And what we need is more information and more transparency, I think, about what actually happens in those meetings after they're done, before they sign the agreements. And that should be coming to the public. You know, this organization, CSPP, does a good job of getting that information out there. That's really what we need to do. They need to see what Jeff Wickman, our retirement director, has. That kind of information should be made available to everybody.
Tomas.
As the only member up here who's actually filed complaints for acts of elected members as it related to negotiations, I would say that no, you should be electing people into office that you can trust to do the job for you. You have too many people that are incumbents or that are just continuing bad policy and we're not checking them. You have, at least in Nevada, more than 1,200 pages of budget you still can't read. So that's $700 million of budget. So I would say we need to elect people who are leaders and who will make the right decisions.
Al?
This is one of my pet peeves with grand jury reports. 13 dedicated people sit down and try to be reasonable and examine things, and they get discounted immediately. I think the transparency of having citizens that are knowledgeable, like CCSP, that know and understand pensions, working with the supervisors and reviewing things would be an advantage to everybody, so we end up with a sustainable program. Thank you.
Alex?
Yeah, I'd like to see a CSPP actually be appointed to handle this, what we're talking about. I don't trust the supervisors to appoint anybody but their stooges to take care of it. So CSPP have brought the issues forward over the last 4 years. We would not be talking about pensions if it weren't for CSPP. So you have to give them a lot of credit. And every time I see a criticism of them, I just think, my God. So one other thing. I don't think politicians should get pensions. I don't think supervisors should get a pension. Public service should be its own reward.
Myself in the unexpected position of agreeing with Alex on at least one of the points that he made, which is which is to give a lot of credit to CSPP. I mean, CSPP has had a significant impact on our county. They've been invited into the process. They provided a lot of input on pensions, and I think that that's been very helpful in terms of broadening out the communication. I do not think opening up the collective bargaining process to a citizens committee would be fruitful. We saw the impact of that in Santa Clara County after they adopted COIN, and they lost over 100 of their public safety employees, fire and public safety employees. That is not what we want to have happen in our county.
So, yes, I think there should be a citizen oversight committee, and I'll tell you why. Back to the enhancement report that the grand jury did for looking at that, they found that there were 23 violations in four different areas of the law in that time period between 2001 and 2006. So I think what we can have as a hope for the high expectations of anyone sitting and making those decisions, there's also a track record that that doesn't always turn out that way. The Citizen Oversight Committee is consistent with my idea of having greater transparency, better fiscal accountability, and citizen oversight.
Thank you. Thank you for CSPP for the questions. We're now going to go to the citizens' questions, and some of you filed cards which were color-coded. So we're going to start off by doing a topic which is directed to District 2 candidates, and that's and so the other candidates that have been on the color-coded, I'm just going to keep the questions to the district in which the questions are asked. So you're not being excluded for any other reason, but it'll come to you sooner or later. District 2, which is the three folks at the end here, we'll start with Frank. East Bay commuters using the Richmond-San Rafael Bridge is the topic. What would you do to improve traffic flow from northbound 101 over the Richmond Bridge? Frank Egger.
We're being impacted by Silicon Valley's impact on San Francisco, which is impacting Marin. The traffic to get onto the Bay Bridge in the afternoon is unbearable. Probably an hour and a half to hour 45 minutes. So what do folks do? They head north, the Golden Gate Bridge, free. They cross Richmond Santa Fe Bridge, free. Well, we do electronic toll taking. Now it's time to start electronic toll taking for the northbound Golden Gate Bridge and the eastbound Richmond Santa Fe Bridge. Number one. And number two, we're going to have to get that third lane open. Both directions need a third lane. Fast.
Kevin.
We need the third lane. We need to have it now. We need to have it without the protracted environmental review process that is not needed for that particular project. It is only being required because of other bells and whistles that are being attached to that, including the bike lane. We need to take a hard look at the Greenbrae interchange. There are opportunities for that interchange to actually move traffic through it more efficiently and expeditiously. And lastly, we need to make sure that we are managing traffic on Sir Francis Drake. We have a Sir Francis Drake Rehabilitation and Improvement Project taking reasonable and responsible steps to reduce traffic congestion on Sir Francis Drake is one of the most important things that we can do to help the traffic within our district.
Okay.
Yes, ditto for me. We have to open up that third lane as soon as possible. We have to make improvements on East Sir Francis Drake as well as in the corridor on the west side of Sir Francis Drake. And we also have to make improvements up at the connection in San Rafael at Bellum, because if we only improve the East Sir Francis Drake access to Richmond San Rafael Bridge, we're going to divert some of that traffic from San Rafael down there. We're going to not solve the problem. We have to have a parallel process, improve access at Bellum, improve access at East Sir Francis Drake, and then that third lane will make a huge difference for congestion in the Greenbrae.
Thank you, Second District candidates. Third District candidates, this is a question relates to Strawberry, and we're going to start with Kate Sears, and then we'll go to Kirsch.
Microphone.
Question, should the county approve medical offices at the Belvedere Place office building in Strawberry? One, two, should the county approve Branson School's relocation to Strawberry? Third District.
All right, so now comes our lesson in the Brown Act. As a sitting county supervisor, I cannot say how I will vote on an issue coming before our board until that issue comes to our board. Those candidates who are not currently sitting supervisors do not have that particular restriction. So I can't tell you. If the question is, how am I going to vote? I can't tell you that. I can tell you, and I'll talk about seminary in particular, the lens that I will look through in evaluating any project on the seminary property. It needs to align with the community plan and the countywide plan. It needs to be right-sized for the particular property. It needs to be, whatever is proposed needs to be situated on that piece of property correctly. It needs to have elements that are of benefit to the community, and it needs to go through a full and thorough environmental review. It obviously also needs to be the subject of very extensive and thorough and open community conversation.
Susan Carter.
Okay, this is with 1 minute. Is there 1 minute for these two questions? Okay, so for Branson. Branson is not zoned in the old plan for a 1,000 student body campus with 200 teachers coming in and with tearing down 211 units of current affordable housing to build 304 units of new housing. So I think it's possible for the community to look at the issue of Branson not to be restricted by, you know, the Brown Act in terms of having conversations about that. It should probably not even be going forward with the magnitude of the size of Branson. In terms of Belvedere Place, the big issue is that it adds 1,200 trips a day to traffic coming in and out. That's what studies say, is that if you go from an administrative building to a medical office building, that's how much you're increasing traffic. And a community should not have to endure that kind of increased, you know, inhibition of safety and well-being in your community by approving that kind of change when the building was built with a condition that it would never be medical office space.
Are you willing to support a ban on pesticides on lands owned and managed by Marin County? Yes. Mary.
Absolutely, yes.
The state of California has designated glyphosate, which is the most commonly used herbicide in the county, as a known carcinogen. We cannot continue spreading known carcinogens on our county land.
Dennis.
I think our county goal should be to reach no pesticides, but we're not quite there yet. I think we need to use good practices, like the precautionary principle, and have options available. I also think we need to work on the public sector because so much of our pesticides are being used on the public side, and the county needs to do a better job reaching out and educating the public.
Wendy.
I think you meant private.
I'm sorry, private, I didn't.
Okay. I pretty much agree with what Mr. Rodoni just said. I think that we should have a goal of getting to zero pesticide use. But I think much more important is the tremendous amount of pesticides that are used on private lands, which pose a far greater risk than what we're doing right now on our public lands.
Dominic.
Thank you. So I think we need to be very diplomatic about this. We'd love to get down to zero pesticide use within our public lands and what happens here in our towns. And so I just think, again, we need to start reaching out into the community to say, if you guys want to come and pick weeds, our government needs to do a better job of getting out into the public and telling them where they're thinking about spraying. And then if the public is willing to jump in and start picking weeds, then we should go that route and we don't have to spray. But I would never take that option off the table because you have non-invasive species that can absolutely inundate an entire county. And I just think you need to have that option on the table just in case something happens.
Come on.
So as the lone hazmat responder, I've actually been sprayed with Corexit, and there are other carcinogens like M&Ms and food coloring, so I don't know where you stop, but I'm not up for a ban. I do think you need to have weapons at disposal if you need to be able to attack something. That's just a tactical phrasing, but you know, it has to be an option, but I think the county, I think it's 0.1% is what the county currently does. And I think that the county has put in a lot of practices in place that absolutely reduce that amount and only need to do it in absolute circumstances, so.
Yeah.
Absolutely, I would
fan it. It was in my original statement. I went up to Lake Sonoma, actually, and talked the Corps of Engineers into stop using Roundup. When it comes to safety and health, we have to put that as a top priority. We have the money and we have the option. I just have to say the California, the Corps of Engineers uses CDC prisoners and also uses CAL FIRE to do burns. So there are creative ways to do this other than using a poison toxin.
We should ban pesticide use, Roundup. Let's put people to work pulling the broom out. I've done it myself. Once you do it, you go back again. It's taken care of. Keep an eye on it. All the jobs we can create, people need work. So that's what we should do.
Alex, thank you. That was directed to the 4th District. I'm now going to ask a question which is going to be directed to all the candidates. It's a very simple question, which is a challenge. Answer very simple. Give a very simple answer. And who shall we start with? Let's start with Wendy, who's looking at me right now. Might as well start with Wendy. Here's what the room will be. The room will be Wendy, and then Dennis down there. We will come back, and we'll end up over here with Dominic. So, starting with you. Just let you know the room.
Okay.
If elected,
we don't have a question yet, right?
If elected, will you vote to implement AB 1421, also known as Laura's Law?
Laura's Law. Laura's Law is...
By the way, on some of these, I'm going to ask to make it easier for the folks, yes or no on the explanation, so we can kind of little expedite the process. Because questions which are basically asking the yes or no. But you can feel free to...
Yeah, because it's not a yes or no question. What Laura's Law wants to be is it wants to be a law that will allow people, family members, to put people in treatment who are not aware of their own mental illness. And I would support that if Laura's Law did that. Unfortunately, I know people who have gone through it with their family members, and in the end, they were not able to admit their family members. They were not able to put them in treatment. It doesn't have any teeth to it. So if we need to go back to the legislator and get a law that actually has teeth in it so we can get what we want, it's a false promise.
Yes, I would support Laura's Law. It's a very important instrument to use. If you're on the street anywhere in West Marin or in San Rafael, no question in my mind, we need to set the law. Thank you.
Right.
I have a lot of questions about it. My wife is a marriage family therapist, and I will be talking with her more about it, but generally speaking, I'm opposed to the concept.
Mary.
Yeah, I would have to look more into that. I'm not a fan of it.
Brent.
They need to pass that mic down.
Yeah, we'll keep this one on this side. You guys keep that one on that side.
I appeared at the Board of Supervisors meeting when they took up Laura's Law. I testified in favor of it. The city of Santa Fe is an exact example of what's going wrong with our county, and Laura's Law can help. It can help, and if I'm elected, I will vote to implement Laura's Law.
Kevin.
Thanks, Frank. My answer is yes. We have a very serious problem in this county. It's growing worse. In District 2, part of our jurisdiction encompasses San Rafael, and I know from day-to-day conversations that I have with people who live over there that this is an ongoing challenge that needs dramatic action. If Laura's Law will help us accomplish that action, I am completely in favor of it.
Amy.
My response is no, not right now, but if we're not able to, with improving our services and coordination out of emergency site, creating capacity with full service partnership spots for our severely mentally ill, if we're not able to reach out and get those folks into services who we know are candidates for Laura's Law into services over the course of the next year, then in January I'm ready to reconsider.
So my heart goes out to every one of us, and we've probably all been touched with people who are dealing with mental illness. I am opposed to this law, and I think it's not quite come far enough yet, and I'll tell you why. I think we already have some tools that are able to be used. We've got, you know, police if there's instances of violence. We've got 5150s if people are a danger to themselves or others. This law is currently set up to be an involuntary but an involuntary forcing people who don't want to take medication, especially psychiatric drugs, to be on these medications. And I've seen what that has done to people, as many of you probably have too. So I think there's a civil rights issue, and I think we need to be really careful before we move forward with it.
So the fact of the matter is that Laura's Law does not allow you to force people to take their medications. And my concern was that our county increase our services so that we really are able to provide the best services we can, that we increase our teams who deal with people face-to-face. That's what's been proven to have the most dramatic impact on people with mental health. And that's exactly what we're moving forward with doing with our Health and Human Services programs, enhancing and enriching those programs. We did, as my colleague Supervisor Rice said, leave the door open to, if we find that the steps that we are taking are not having the impact that we hope they will have, we left the door open to look again at Laura's Law. But we were not convinced that the law itself really provided the tools and would have the results that so many people hoped that it would.
Alex. Yeah. Now, this is starkly personal, but if we had Laura's Law, it would have saved our family a couple years of hell. Also, 5150s don't work that well. They're three-stage devices. The psychiatric social workers, psychiatrists say if they could have somebody for 7 days, medicate them, they could generally get them to the point where they're comprehensive and they can talk, they can understand what the situation they're in and help themselves out. But right now, these holds, even the 72-hour holds, aren't 72 hours. At best, maybe 12 hours, and then they're back out on the streets.
Yes.
Come on.
I heard, actually, thanks to the county having a website, I was actually able to watch online, although that system is antiquated. I think you have a brand new Health and Human Services director that is compassionate. He gave a good argument to the Board of Supervisors about what actions they needed to take place. Give him the time to implement those, and I think come back as leaders and say, the program's not working, let's change it.
Dominic.
Well, we'll see if the program doesn't work, but I think that's the right direction that our supervisors went in. I wouldn't vote for it right now either. I think that what we need to do is give it time. We don't have the infrastructure to handle all those people that might need that help, so we need to start building that, and that's where we need to get started, is just creating our own infrastructure. We don't need to be told to help for the mentally ill by waiting for Laura's Law. We need to just be out there helping them right now.
Thank you, Dominic. We're going to go to a question, and we're going to take a break after this question. The question is going to be directed to the second supervisorial district, and I think last time, sir, Frank, this is a good meeting. It's a topic you probably haven't had to address so far in the campaign. It's called flooding in the Ross Valley.
I don't know anything about this topic.
It's a conglomeration of questions. Many people have questions. Obviously, they relate to the need or the lack of need for detention bases, But the basic question is, what would you do about flooding in the Ross Valley? Kevin, and then we'll do Katie and then Frank.
First of all, I turn the spigot off of endless rounds of consultants and studies that basically regurgitate work that has been done for the last 10 years without sticking a shovel in the ground. Specifically with respect to the detention basins are unproven and unnecessary. I looked at the funding that was proposed for a memorial park. Most of the funding that was proposed for that was oriented towards rehabilitation of recreational facilities. The capabilities of those detention basins are limited, they're unproductive, and they're irresponsible. We need to redirect floodwaters to the extent that we can, and flooding is a challenging issue, I understand that, but there are opportunities without relying on existing recreational facilities to redirect floodwaters into natural areas where the floods can percolate down into the aquifer and get it out of the system.
Well, I've been pretty deep in the flooding issue now for many years, and I do believe the science and the engineering and the studies that have been done that say that we really do need to do some kind of detention if we're going to address, really address in a big way, flooding in the Ross Valley. That said, I also understand that you can't put in place a public project that doesn't have public support. So right now, the focus needs to be on getting the projects done that create improved capacity in the creeks, remove constriction in the creeks, focus on Phoenix Lake, focus on fixing that Army Corps project that doesn't work properly, and then we can take a look at detention basins again. The public isn't ready. That's what Memorial Park taught us.
Right.
$8 million have been spent on consultants. Detention basins at Memorial Park and Lefty Gomez Field were Supervisor Rice's signature projects. When folks in San Anselmo were trying to save Memorial Park last year from a flood control detention basin, I jumped in and assisted them with the preparation of their initiative, Measure D, and voters in San Anselmo overwhelmingly voted not to dig up their kids' park. I'm working with moms and dads in Fairfax now to save Lefty Gomez Field. We need green flood water mitigation programs like replacing imitation turf fields at our schools with real sod, installing cisterns, collecting rainwater, enlarging culverts, cleaning creeks, and raising some structures. We surely don't need the detention basins at Memorial Park and Lefty Gomez Field.
Thank you all. We're going to take a 10-minute break. We're going to come back. We're not going to go that long afterwards.
Avenue is City of Mill Valley, but we have a lot of collaborations I do with the City of Mill Valley on traffic issues. One, let's go Tan Valley. We put up the median stanchions to stop those left turns into the ARCO station. So far, they're working great from all the feedback from that community. We're working closely with the City of Mill Valley on the East Blythedale 101 East Tiburon Boulevard overpass and trying to figure out how to ease the traffic through there. We're making a lot of traffic light adjustments. We just had a meeting with Caltrans yesterday, made some significant progress in rewiring. I mean, I'm going to take a deep dive and be specific because I got asked. Rewiring some of the lights so that, for example, when you are trying to get across, come south, I'm on the Tiburon Boulevard side, you come south to Redwood Frontage Road, it's a long intersection, you totally stop the traffic going east and west. If we could rewire that light, it will make a big difference, and that's exactly what we were talking to Caltrans about yesterday. We're also talking about if we can find the funds going forward, and this is something that implicates Chevron as well as Mill Valley, widening, putting potentially an additional lane for that northbound on-ramp onto 101 to ease some of the traffic flow there. We are focusing in particular on the Tiburon side of the 101 overcrossing. There's a lot of backup on East Blythedale. I have been pushing Caltrans to try to figure out how to let us in our cars get on that 101 southbound on-ramp off of East Blythedale more readily. That turned out to be nearly an impossible feat with Caltrans because they had a lot of complicated things that they thought needed to be done with a retaining wall and the wall and safety for bikes. And we finally decided that, no, let's focus on the Tiburon side. If we can solve the light timing, we can control some of the right turns and the left turns, we will have an impact on traffic. Did you hold that up before and I ignored it? I'm sorry. I thought that was a really long minute. But I just kept going because you weren't ringing the bell.
You thought it was crazy.
I did. I thought it was a really good addictive call and I appreciated it. So thank you for that 10 minutes.
Susan Kirk. Traffic in Mill Valley.
Well, so Kate and I agree on a lot of the specifics that she pointed out in terms of solving this problem. So I'm going to, you know, answer the question with that idea of looking at overall what I think helps solve our traffic problem in all of the Southern District as well as in Marin. And I think this is a three-tier solution. One is that we should stop giving approval for any projects that are going to make traffic worse, like the Bentley Holdings or Branson, until we have proof that there are mitigation measures that keep traffic flowing smoothly now. Number two, as many of the suggestions that Kate brought forward, we should pick the low-hanging fruit. So we need to synchronize lights, we need school bus programs, doing the lane striping so there could be easier move on and off. Those are all really important ideas. And overall, I think what we need to do is the third tier is to look at more creative solutions. You know, I love the idea that we could, if Amazon and UPS can deliver things in 24 hours, that we could do something better with cars or vehicles on demand, and that we could get rid of a whole lot of cars and be able to have a call card at our front door within a 10-minute time period to get us anywhere we needed to go, and that would help a lot.
Next question is a different district, and why folks choose various colored cards, I can't tell you, but they do. And this is not really 2nd District specific, but it is directed to the 2nd District. So, Kevin, I'm going to start with you. It's very quick. Are you for or against the merger of the Association of Area Governments and the Metropolitan Transportation Commission? If so, explain why.
I am against it. I think that this is actually a brazen attempt to take over our ability to continue to exercise local control within our communities. I have, like a lot of people, a lot of problems with the way ABAG has conducted its affairs over the years. I think ABAG needs some significant reform in order to make sure that it respects the interests and the needs of the people who live in our community. And we may actually need to go to some other organization altogether to get out of ABAG. But I think that's important for us to stay to have as an option on the table. But if you're asking the specific question whether MTC and ABAG ought to get together, the answer is absolutely no.
That's the question. Thank you, Kevin.
My answer is no as well, for all the reasons that Kevin mentioned.
Brent.
Yes, I am a no. In fact, I support Assemblymember Levine's legislation that would reform the Metropolitan Transportation Commission. That is one agency that needs reforming. So we here in Marin, we've got our difficulties, but if our supervisors get up to speed, we'll be able to handle MTC and ABAG. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. Next question, again, this is a similar question, folks. It could be asked of any district. It's a white card, so it's asked for the 4th district here. But I'm going to combine a couple of questions. It relates to affordable housing, and in particular, the first one is position on homeless children. But the bottom line question is, what's your feelings, thoughts, and proposals insofar as affordable housing, workforce housing for local workers who are already in Marin County, is the question. So I'm going to start with Brian, because he hasn't started anywhere. Then we're going to go this way in the 4th District and finish with Mary.
Affordable housing is key. A majority of our civil servants and, do not live in the county, and so the traffic is being driven by that. We need some type of affordable housing. Right now, we only require 10% of new developments to be affordable. The county is doing a relatively decent job in acquiring various housing that's existing affordable as it can afford it. But as it is today, the latest statistics was that in 2015, no net aggregate new affordable housing have been added, and it's something that we really need to look at.
Yeah.
Workforce and affordable housing should be the focus of the County Marin. We have a new strategy how to do that. Second units, junior accessory units, making sure every development has all the income levels in it, including workforce housing. It's so important to have people live in Marin and work in Marin. If we're going to solve any traffic problems, that's the place to start.
Wendy.
Well, I've been working on housing issues for about 30 years now, and we have to find new avenues. Inclusionary zoning has simply created housing for the very, very low income, and then the rest is luxury housing, and that does not solve our problem. We do need a balance of housing. We are out of balance. We don't have housing choices. So what are some of the solutions that we're looking at? Junior second units is a great one, but it only serves a certain population. We also need family housing. One of the solutions that's being looked at by CLAM, which is affordable housing in West Marin, is something similar to what MALT does. MALT buys development rights off of the ranches. What CLAM wants to do is buy the land for people who are house rich and cash poor. And I see my time is almost up, so let me finish my thought. So for people who are house rich and cash poor, it gives them an infusion of cash. They still own the physical structure of their home, but they no longer have the land costs encumbered, and therefore that housing becomes permanently affordable. The more we can do that, the more we can preserve the housing that we already have.
Dominic.
Yeah, affordable housing is very important for our workforce. We need to make sure that we have opportunities for the people, and it was mentioned a lot of people. Well, 60 to 70% of our workforce in Marin County comes from other areas to get here. And so I think it's extremely important that we try to find this workforce housing for them, the people that perform important services and public services for us here in Marin. The idea of throwing out amnesty for those who have second units already, I think is a good idea to get it started, to give people the incentive to take those second units, which are currently illegal on their house, on their properties, and get them up to code and move them forward. So I think amnesty is a good idea. Might even need the idea of tax incentives for a couple of years. So I think we have to look outside the box. I mentioned earlier the idea of agricultural zoned lands. While they're A60, one home for every 60 acres, second units are currently not allowed. So why don't we work on that? I think second units should be allowed on the ag lands. People that are teachers up in Tomas should be able to live a lot closer than, say, driving from Santa Rosa. There's plenty of ranches out there. But we need to provide options.
Tomas.
Well, if you follow me on Facebook, you know, I just posted a statistic that said it costs you about 110% of your median income to actually afford a mortgage in Marin County. So there are factors that contribute to it being expensive in Marin. We're not going to be able to build our way out of that. When you look at the disparity between the available jobs and the available housing, the disparity is too great. And as Brian's already mentioned, you're already at net neutral. So you're not going to build your way out of it. You need to make government more efficient. Right now, I've heard from contractor friends of mine, it takes several months to get a permit through. So just by allowing second units and additional homes, it may not be right. So we have to look at the entire system in terms of how we approve that kind of stuff, but also partnerships. Large employers need to be able to partner with nonprofits as well as government to see what we can make available.
Now,
well, we've got to make sure we take care of the affordable housing we already have. And I think it's a real shame of what has been done in Marin City. That is just a sad state of affairs that we've let that place go to the condition it's in. I think definitely we got to look at smaller infill projects. I'm very much against high density affordable housing. I think it creates an area where you're putting all low-income or very low-income people in the same spot. I believe we should move them out into the rest with small infills. We should go with second homes and go with smaller development options. Thank you.
Alex.
I think Miranda's already built out. Market forces control who gets to live here and who doesn't. It's tough. We have no control over this. It's too bad, but that's the way it is. And in fact, a lot of us, when we came here, we agreed to live by those terms. And it's just unfortunate for people that can't afford to live here. They can't afford to live here. Affordable housing, affordable for who? I don't think I can afford affordable housing. Workforce housing, we have enough. We're built out, we're overcrowded, and I want to stop all development in Marin. Maybe a couple second units or junior units, that's fine. Or Habitat for Humanity wants to come in and do a few units. But that's it.
Mary.
Well, I'll just be parroting anything that's already been said. I am really not for development. I think we are built out, but I know we do need some affordable units, and I believe we're mandated by the state to add some over the next few years. So I would like to see that we do small-scale development that is environmentally proper and fits in with the communities. But I'm really not a fan of any more development.
Okay. The next question. I have big news. Big news. I don't want to start a rush right now. But the second cheese tray has been delivered.
Cheese tray.
Take your time. It won't take offense if you go for a cheese tray piece, unless you're okay. I'm sure they all encourage. Am I right? They all encourage you to go to cheese tray. All right. Next question. This is going to go to everybody. It's going to seem not meant to be a criticism of anyone, because people, even incumbents, can find an answer to this. At least I think I could when I served in office. And I'm going to start with Frank, go all the way down this way, if it's okay. Just very simple. Frank, it's not directed at any district. What do you consider the biggest wasted resources by the county or their Board of Supervisors? In other words, if you're an incumbent, you might say, what mistakes did I make? Everybody makes mistakes except Donald Trump. You know that? Or if you're not incumbent, what do you see as there was a waste of their resources, resources being wasted on it? Frank.
Now that's an easy one. How about the $8 million that have been spent on consultants studying flood mitigation in the Ross Valley? $8 million. And now what? We're finding out that it may not work? Come on.
Kevin.
I actually agree with Frank on that one. I think I said as much earlier, but I think there's actually a bigger problem, particularly facing those of us who live in District 2, and it's the failure to deal with our traffic problem. The consistent failure to reduce traffic congestion and focus on traffic congestion as the single most important problem and challenge that we have within that community. There are relatively simple, easy solutions that will have a material impact on reducing traffic congestion on Sir Francis Drake. We've had funding that has been developed for that over an extended period of time. The projects that have been developed by the county to date are inadequate to actually address the traffic congestion problems that we face. That is the biggest waste of money that we have in our community.
I would say the biggest waste of resources in recent memory was the SAP financial system, in which we threw away, I was not part of that vote, $30 million on a system that doesn't work. Bringing it back closer to right now, I would say where the county wastes resources is on designing, doing development work of projects, designing projects without adequate public involvement from the very beginning. And if you don't bring the public along and have them involved from the start, then you waste a lot of time because you're going to have to do it at some point. And I would disagree with Kevin about the Sir Francis Drake project. One, it's had a great community process. The community has been part of it, has provided input, has made it a better project all the way along, and we're minimizing how much we're spending on that upfront piece. So I'm looking forward to some progress on Sir Francis Drake, some traffic relief, and then more when we get to the east side.
So I agree with that idea of bringing the public in early. I guess I want to go back to that idea that the county has $21 million to do something with, and that it's using that money to do cosmetic and fix the leaky roof at Civic Center. To me, it's a matter of the priorities, and for all we talk about needing affordable housing, there are 300 units that need repair. Our Board of Supervisors, sitting as the housing authority, has deferred that maintenance like an absentee landlord. We hear about that. So the $16 million, there should be some plan to take from the $21 million, get some of that going into helping out the people who are living in deferred maintenance.
Susan Kirsch, thank you, Supervisor Kate.
So it's hard not to point to our computer system as a huge loss of the county, predated both my colleague and I. Mm-hmm. One of the other ways I think in which we waste money is always planning for, let's call it the Tesla model instead of the Cadillac model. Instead of thinking more practically about common sense solutions. We had a breakthrough with Caltrans a couple of months ago when they wanted to come in and put in a fourth traffic light on East Tiburon Boulevard. And we said, wait a minute, there are easier, practical, common sense solutions to solve that problem. And it only took us 6 months to get common sense into that state agency, which was, at least we got there. I'm also having the same conversation with Caltrans about addressing flooding at Manzanita Pohono. They say the only way to do it is to raise the bridge over Richardson Bay. I say that's ridiculous, and it doesn't sound like you're listening to us. And there's more commonsensical short-term intermediate. Let's get to 75%, not 100%. On Marin City, the issue there is a $160 million problem that's been caused by the federal government, HUD, thank you very much, cutting down year over year over year on the funds available to the Housing Authority in Marin. The process that has been going on, community process for the last year, is intended to find a feasible, workable solution, and I'm looking at you and I'm done.
So Caltrans is horribly overstaffed with very expensive engineers, but I think our biggest waste is on consultants. I can't see why our staff at Civic Center can't do this work. I mean, are these people not trained well enough? Why are they even working for us? If they can't do the job, then they should get going. We'll find somebody to replace them.
Now.
Yes, I think it's really a combination of a couple of things that have been said. Definitely consultants, and definitely projects heading in the wrong direction without public input that turn out to be just a tremendous waste of money and time. So, but we got to solve the contractors and the consultants. We got to use the staff whenever we can. And unfortunately, consultants are often a reason to be able to say somebody else did it. Thank you.
Resources, people, us, the citizens. I had to give up a day's worth of pay just to come and try to file for running for office because there's no electronic pay system. You can't actually work with the county electronically to be able to resolve things. You have to walk down there, take days off of work. I already have two jobs. I haven't had a vacation since 2012, and leave is very important to me, but I still can't do business with the county without coming down there. And the same is true for most of our public jurisdictions. So our wasted resource right now is our time, our human energy and our power. We need to make government more efficient. The six entities that run, at least where I live in the unincorporated area of Novato, would require me to go through 1,200 pages of budget material. As a board member, I could barely keep up with the 300-page board materials that we were all getting on a monthly basis. I can't imagine how the citizenry is able to get involved. So we have to modernize. We need to pioneer new ways of being able to engage the public. Thank you.
With so much having just been said, it's easy to echo everything that I've already heard. I mean, obviously, I think the SAP financial system, $30 million down the drain when it comes to straight cash, that was awful that our county did. And consultants have clearly been mentioned. I think that's become a big issue. But I do understand there's a need for some consultants where we don't have experts in that particular field. But the last thing I want to talk about really is time, kind of as Tomas just mentioned. But for me, I look at the time that is spent because we don't engage the public early enough. So it's time that gets spent trying to get permits across, trying to get new businesses into our local economy, you know, and that's what we need. And I think local businesses suffer because they spend so much time fighting with counties and cities, for that matter, to try to get started, to get anything going. And that inefficiency in our government makes it very difficult and scares businesses away. And I can't tell you how many businesses I know that wanted to come into the area and didn't because of all the hassles they went through.
Mine's not quite so sexy, but it's similar, actually, paperwork. The amount of paperwork that the staff has to fill out in order to do anything takes hours and hours of their time. Sometimes if they want to write a grant that might get you $25,000, you have to spend $10,000 just to write the grant. A lot of this is about getting money from state and federal money. I like to say that federal money is expensive. It is very expensive because of all the requirements that go along with it. And streamlining that process and eliminating a lot of the paperwork and consolidating the paperwork would save us quite a lot of money, maybe as much as that $30 million that we spent on that computer system.
Yep. Thank you. Certainly the computer system is something we can all point to. I think there's an assumption that consultants are money being wasted on consultants. If I was elected to the Board of Supervisors, I'd have three basic questions I've asked every time staff proposed a consultant. Do we have staff on the county payroll that can do the job? Secondly, are they available to do the job? And if they're not, I'm going to ask why not? And thirdly, if we have to go outside, we want to competitively bid out the project that we're bidding and make sure we get the best possible price. So that would be my policy at the board talking about consultants. And then we'll see if it truly is wasting money or not, if we ask those questions.
Brian.
Two really quick stories. A bridge needs to be repaired in my community. It goes from a one-lane road to another one-lane road, but the county wants to make it a two-lane bridge. It makes absolutely no sense. Another example, very quick, of the MMWD felt that they needed an enormous water tank up above on the ridge over my house, and by simply doing the math, sitting down and doing an analysis, we realized that the tank wasn't necessary. We sat down with MMWD board members and convinced them, showing them the map, that it wasn't necessary. We saved tens of millions of dollars.
Lawyers. I think we waste too much money on lawyers at the county, especially lawyers that misinform county judges, as was with the case when we were forced to try to sue the county to preserve our semi-rural environment in our little neighborhood. And that and all the other things that were already stated about consultants and things like that, but definitely lawyers. The fact that we even have to try to sue to do some of the things, to stop people from doing things, it's ludicrous.
I want to thank everybody here who asked some great questions, and I also want you to know that some of them we tried to combine orally into the topic was covered. Obviously, we haven't got to them all, and the math wasn't as such that we could. The math also tells us that if we only take a couple of minutes for each candidate, we're going to be bumping up against the 9 o'clock departure time. So I'm going to ask you folks to give an appeal, if you will, to the folks here on why they should vote for you in the 4th District, 3rd District, or 2nd District. But I'm going to ask you, if you can, to the greatest extent, to hold it to 2 minutes each. Please vote for me. Works really well as a rule, but a little more than sometimes appropriate. I said before we started with the Frank over here on the right, and we're going to finish up first with Mary, and then we're going to go straight down the line.
Okay. Please vote for me, because I can represent the low-income community. I've spent a lot of my years of adult life in low-income, and so I can relate. We have a widening economic disparity in this county, and we need representation on that end of the spectrum. Plus, I have a reputation for honesty and integrity, and I have a long-standing, lot of experience listening. That's one of the things that a musician needs and a singer needs, is to learn how to listen and to come to a satisfactory result by combining all the different viewpoints, in this case, instruments. And so that's one reason. Another reason is just because I'm a good person.
Thank you. Eric, Brian.
I've spent 30 years reviewing a variety of projects in and around the 4th District. During those 30 years, I think that I have built an enormous set of tools and skills that essentially will allow me to be an extremely effective supervisor, doing what supervisors do, which is reviewing policies, reviewing projects, reviewing proposals. That's all I've been doing for 30 years, and I think I can do an excellent job.
Thank you, Brian. Dennis?
I'm deeply committed to serving our district and county. My experience in local government as an elected office holder gives me the experience necessary to start working day one. I understand how county, state, and federal governments function, and I know how to make all those entities work for the people of District 4 and the county. If you care about West Marin and Marin as I do, you'll join me on June 7th. I'm all in for Marin. Are you?
Wendy.
We have a sprawling district in the 4th District, and we need someone who understands the little issues of the communities of West Marin and the larger issues of the communities in East Marin. I live in West Marin, and I've been working in East Marin, and I understand the big issues of traffic and housing, and I also know about the little villages of West Marin, and I know about the need for protecting our ranches and our agriculture, the need to protect our environment. All of those, you need somebody who has a broad range of experience. Plus, in my work, I have been able to bring people together and create a situation where government works in partnership with the citizens, where the citizens get heard and get responded to, and we get results. And that's what I will bring to the Board of Supervisors. So on June 7th, please vote for Wendy Kallins. Thank you. And if you go to my website, wendykallins.com, that's spelled with an I and a K.
Wendy, thank you. Dominic.
I think you need and you deserve a supervisor that knows how to build bridges, bring people together. I've spent the last 15 years in the I community bringing us closer with the environmental community. That was a huge gap for the past 30 years. And I feel very proud to know that I helped bring them back together and put issues on the table and learn how to compromise. And so that's very important that you have a supervisor who's willing to listen to both sides of an issue and make thoughtful, educated decisions about it. Besides that, I feel like I'm without a doubt, have the most history in this county, going back over 120 years. And my heritage, my family's history is extremely important to me in protecting West Marin. And I want to continue to be able to do that. So please vote for me. Check out my website at grossiforsupervisor.com. Thank you.
Come on.
I think I started a mantra there. Tomasformarin.com, number four. So I wanted to thank CSPP. I know I didn't thank early on, but this has been actually a very good learning experience. I take a lot of notes so I can go back and review things because I keep myself well informed. When I go out in the field, and I spent 3.5 months from August to November deployed out to tsunamis or a super typhoon, we also had two hurricanes and the fires in Lake and Calaveras counties, and I have a very background that I don't only understand the business environment, but I also understand how government works. And when bureaucrats are telling you something, you need to be skeptical. You need to be able to hold them to account. You need to be able to research and then be able to stand on the principles that you've already built in the foundation of your community and say, look, this isn't okay, and we're going to change it. And you continue to say that until it actually changes. That's what it's going to take. It's going to take real leadership to be elected into this office. You know, you've got somebody that's been there for 20 years. Continuing saying that I've got a long history isn't necessarily qualifying for this position. Somebody who's willing to pioneer and who's willing to look at innovative ideas to get us into the next generation and to pioneer us to give our lives back to ourselves. Our traffic is worse. I don't feel any safer in my home. Those are two critical things that I'd love to address. Thank you. I appreciate your vote.
Thank you, Tomas. Al.
Al Dugan. Just want to go over a little of my background quickly. I retired as an underwriter for Lloyd's of London. And I worked on extraordinarily complex financial issues, and for such companies as Apple, Google, Amazon. So I have really strong financial analysis skills. I think we're at a critical point here. One of the critical points is the MTC takeover of AMAD. And I can tell you I understand that process and have worked on that for the last 3 or 4 years, and I know it well. And then finally, we've got to deal with the pensions. And we got to deal with the budget issues. We're going to go to a deficit in 2018-2019 that starts at $1.3 million and projected over the next 3 years, it goes to $5 million. We've got to have a strong financial leadership. And I've been a senior executive for the last 24 years. I've made the tough decisions, ask the right questions to make sure we get things done. So I would ask for you to vote for me. You can go on my website and look at my background and experience and the issues. And more importantly, look at who's endorsed me on my website and read what they've actually said, because I've worked with those people and I'm very proud of what was put up there. So it's aldugan4supervisor.org. Thank you.
Hi. For the last 40 years, I've made it a practice to study and criticize the county government. I also come up with solutions once in a while. It's hard to sit here and promote myself. I'm not used to that. The Chronicle said of me that I was an anti-politician iconoclast who thinks outside the box. That was their opinion. The IJ recently mentioned me as only a Marin combination of a progressive and tax watchdog. So I'm kind of proud of that label. The Pacific Sun endorsed me 6 years ago in the race for the assembly against Mark Levine. They said that I was a straight talker, that I would be good for the district. The Bohemian said I was humble. What's up? I would do a good job because I'm not going to use this as a stepping stone to higher office. I don't even see myself in maybe more than one term, except I don't want to talk lame duck talk because it kind of takes your power away from you. But I would like to get on the board, stir things up, analyze things, look at things, say, why are we doing it this way? Also, we don't need any more development in Marin. We don't need any more people in Marin. We're overcrowded. It's like the whole earth is overcrowded. I don't know if anybody's noticed. You know, I had one job because my mom had six. And I just have a gut feeling about, I think we've peaked out right now. And I can live with the way it is, but I don't want any more development or growth in Marin. And that's the way it is.
Thanks very much. So since I became a supervisor in June of 2011, I have been to hundreds and hundreds of community meetings around my district and in various parts of the county, listening to people and hearing their concerns. You know, it's easy to make promises. To really get things done, you need to be able to listen to people with an open mind, even those you don't agree with, and really try to figure out what is a way forward. It's great being an activist. We love that. When you're on the board of supervisors, you have to count to three. And you have to be able to weave your way through communities throughout our district. We have strong feelings. I grew up in Sausalito. I know the meaning of contentiousness. You have to be able to find where is the middle ground. And that requires compromise. It requires knowing people and having the relationships to make things happen. It's not easy, and it requires a strategic mind, so when you are sitting on the dais, you're presented with complicated problems for which there is not an easy solution. You're making a decision in real time, and you can't control the folks you're with. That's a very challenging job. You need to be have collegial relations with your colleagues on the board so that you can find a way forward. You need to have good relations in the community. I have those skills. I had 22 years as a lawyer. I'm a negotiator. I'm a mediator. I know how to get out and listen and talk to people and try to find a way forward. We also need to recognize the constraints that all of us work under and some of the really hard decisions that we are going to have to make going forward. And that takes fiber and it takes creativity. We have a lot of smart people in this community. And I think engaging all of us so that all of us have a contribution, we exchange thoughts, we brainstorm together, we try to figure out new ways to do things. We talk a lot about innovation at the county, but we really need to make that happen. How do you shift public service to become more nimble, more responsive, and more collaborative? I'm committed to doing that. I'm committed to getting work done.
Susan Kirsch.
Well, I want to thank CSPP for hosting this event. And for those of you who came tonight with a real interest and concern about pension, I want you to know that I've got the endorsement of CSPP in my candidacy for this election. I'd very much like to represent you on the Board of Supervisors. And I was reminded of one of the quotes that's always been a favorite quote from the German philosopher Goethe, who said, "Whatever you can do or dream you can, begin it. Boldness has genius, power, and magic in it." So in part, I'm on this in this race because I could dream that it could happen. And I know we all hold dreams of what could be going on in Marin. And I invite you to join me with your own boldness. And we work together to have greater transparency, greater fiscal accountability, and more citizen involvement in running the county so that it returns to us and our feeling of being citizens and constituents and together in this community.
So I bring you this job, hands-on experience working out in the community across the district. I bring to this job hands-on experience and real-world experience working in county government and serving on regional boards and having success forging consensus and bringing solutions at both levels. My base of support is broad and strong because of the relationships and trust I've built with residents, with elected officials, and with community leaders from throughout District 2 to develop real solutions to the real and serious challenges we face. I believe in collaboration, not litigation. I work with the community at the ground level, not the theoretical. I don't point fingers, I try to get things done. And finally, I believe in this county and in our capacity and responsibility to continue Marin's great legacy of open space protection and environmental stewardship, of supporting vibrant and unique communities, and in thoughtful planning for the future to sustain it all for the next generation. I appreciate you all giving your time to be here tonight, and even more so, I appreciate that you care so much about county government and about this great county we live in, and I would appreciate your consideration when June 7th rolls around. Thanks.
Katie Rice, thank you.
Well, we're out at the end, so I'll be brief. First of all, I want to thank again Dick for moderating this evening's program. You did a great job, Dick. Thank you. I also want to thank CSPP for hosting this and for bringing out such a great crowd. It's been terrific to have you all here tonight. What I'd like to do is just close very briefly by pointing out what I think is an important distinction between me and both of my opponents in the race for supervisor for District 2. Unlike my opponents, I have not spent my adult life as part of Marin County's political establishment. I have worked my entire professional life as a lawyer, as an environmental lawyer, representing clients in some of the highest courts in the state of California and in the nation itself. I'm very proud of the professional background that I have, and I think that the skills and abilities that I've been able to develop throughout that professional life will make me a really, really good supervisor and a representative of the interests of District 2. I have advocated for clients. I have reached consensus where consensus is possible on behalf of clients. And when consensus is not possible, I have litigated occasionally, successfully, and aggressively to promote the interests of the people that I represent. I've been able to do that for clients for 30 years. I want to be able to do it for the people who live in our community and in our county. And I would be very grateful for the opportunity to play that role as the District 2 supervisor. My website is www.kevinharoff.com. I encourage all of you to go there, learn more about my own background, participate in our campaign, and I look forward to knocking on your doors if you live in District 2 and saying hello. Thank you.
Kevin Harroff.
I've been around long enough to know what works and what doesn't work. I have always been ahead of my time, finding innovative but practical solutions to problems and continue to do so. I'm a co-founder of Friends of the Eel River and the president of the North Coast Rivers Alliance. Marin needs to recapture its environmental legacy. Every salmon coming through the Golden Gate on its way to Sacramento, San Joaquin Bay Delta passes through Marin right here in San Pablo Bay. Marin needs to join the opposition to the massive Delta tunnels that will drive our endangered salmon into extinction. And we need to fight the Metropolitan Water District of Southern California's move to buy Delta Islands to facilitate tunnel construction. I happen to work on the opposite side of environmental issues of Mr. Harrell. I will write a zoning ordinance that will ban fracking in Marin so Marin can join other coastal counties like Mendocino, Santa Cruz, and even San Benito County in banning fracking. If enough counties do it, the state will have to get on board. I will turn around the proposed Marin Local Coastal Plan that would allow 1.5 million square feet of new development in West Marin. Traffic on Sir Francis Drake Boulevard will be adversely impacted if not. My endorsers include the California Nurses Association, former State Senator Noreen Evans, Marty Griffin, the author of Saving the Marin Sonoma Coast, Marin Municipal Water District Director Larry Bragman, San Anselmo Mayors Fort Greene and Paul Chigdale, Suzuki Caddy of Save Lefty Gomez Field, Ginger Suitors Mason, the president of the Pesticide Free Zone, and Crystal Park leader Hugo Landecker. Elect me and you will have a public advocate and a trusted environmentalist at your side at the Civic Center. My past work is a clear indication of the direction that I will take Marin County. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you, Greg. First of all, you just saw something that you don't see too often in the United States these days. 13 intelligent people dealing with issues and treating each other with respect. So consider yourself very fortunate people. So I want to say thank you to the 13 people that treated each other with respect, talked about issues, and obviously are quite intelligent. We have 13 qualified people who take quite different stances. And they did all that with disagreeing on some very fundamental issues at times. So that's a great compliment that we're able to somehow recruit. I think candidate recruitment is one of the toughest things to do in the world these days, because this is quite often a thankless job. We don't really end up saying a lot of thank yous to people who spend an awful lot of life doing our public work. But you guys stayed out here for almost 3 hours. You deserve a lot of comments and endurance. And her group have done a terrific job. This is the first thorough, across-the-board candidates night that I know of in the County of Marin this year. It's a kickoff, and it's probably going to be one of the best and one of the most thorough. That's no criticism of any other group. It's just when you're first, you get a little novelty aspect. And you can see some of these folks are learning as they go, which is great, because that means they're not professional politicians. They kind of get it. So a great group of people on this side, a great group of candidates on that side. I normally say on June 7th, don't forget to vote, but 70% of the people in the North Bay vote absentee, vote by mail. So starting about May 8th, we've got a month to vote. We have the most generous system to vote in America. Easiest, no restraints, no holdback, no excuse if you don't vote, in other words. So you've got great candidates to vote for. You can't claim that's not why you didn't, so please vote. Support these good people, and I know each and every one of them in their heart want to be your supervisor. Thanks again to Jody and the group. Have a nice night, everybody.